Welcome to Your Music Saved Us, where two friends blast ourselves into the past to relive and recontextualize the alternative Christian music we grew up listening to in the 1990s. Yeah! My name's Clifton, and I'll be your host for this episode. Joining me to personally make our first timid introductions into, is this spirit-filled hardcore, Jay? I don't know. You can tell us in a second. The punkest middle schooler you know, Jay. How are you today?
Can we clarify, Clifton, middle school teacher? but I'm doing well. On a side note, I'm kind of terrified of what COVID's doing to schools right now. But Anyway, and I realize this is going to be broadcast probably like a month after we record it, so hopefully things are better, but I'm skeptical. But anyway, I'm fine.
Probably not. Okay. And what are we listening to today, this week?
We are listening to The Blame's sophomore release from 1995, Braille.
All right. How did this make you feel to revisit?
Well, I really thought more about how did this make me feel at the time, and it made me feel tough.
Tough?
Yeah.
Okay. Interesting. All right.
I have a feeling that's not how it made you feel, but we'll get to it.
We'll get into that in a minute. Where were you able to find this to listen to?
It's on Spotify, thank goodness. This was pretty easy to find.
Yeah, actually, all of their stuff is on Spotify, it looks like, even their Gurr albums.
Except for their new album that I don't think is on there.
Oh, you're right.
We'll talk more about that later, yeah.
Yeah, the one that just came out this year, yeah, okay. All right, well, tell us a little bit about the band, Jay.
The Blamed formed in, I'm going to say, I couldn't find it exactly, but I'm going to say 1990 or 1991. Not completely clear, but there's evidence of an early demo tape called Pay the Rent that was recorded in June of 91. So they had to have been banned long enough to at least write those songs. And I should say The Blamed is basically Brian Gray and like a revolving cast of members. So he's originally from the Bay Area, but he kind of migrated down to Los Angeles. And that was kind of before their first real album, which was called 21 on Tooth and Nail Records in 1994. I just found out, I was listening to another podcast, As the Story Grows, which if you guys don't listen to, you should. And there was an interview with Brian, and he talked about his real first band was called Rocks and Pink Cement, which he hates the name of, but I think it's kind of a cool band name. Mm-hmm. They were kind of some kind of punk band. But anyway, The Blamed was like a side project of his. Brian played also in Mortal back in like 93. And so kind of through all that, and as that kind of ended and he shifted out of Mortal, he really wanted to get back into just playing straight ahead punk rock. And that's kind of where The Blamed came from. So their first album was called 21 because it was recorded in 21 hours straight. And this is their second album. And this one has the same drummer as the first one, Jim Chaffin, who was also the drummer for The Crucified, which kind of gave, I think, kind of gave the band early on like an air of, I don't know, respectability or something, because The Crucified had been such like a legendary band in the scene. So it's just Brian and Jim who returned from 21 to this one. And they also added Jeremy Moffat for the vocals, who at one time had played with the kind of thrash metal band Deliverance. And Gary Otosi, who I don't know much more about, but he played bass on this album. So that's, I'll stop there. That kind of gets us up to where the band was at this point. And then obviously The Blamed has quite a bit going on after this album, but we can talk about that, you know, when we get through Frail.
So all that flies in the face of Wikipedia, because they think the band started in 1994 and that 21 either came out in 94 or 96. They're not sure.
Yeah. So listen, Wikipedia is not doing the deep dive that I did. So yeah, they started earlier, and this album actually came out, I think, in January of 95. So this was recorded in 94.
Okay.
And I don't know, they basically said in interviews I was listening with Brian that this was almost like back-to-back with 21. Like, I think just like months later. And this has quite a bit of different sound than 21. And he said part of that was kind of a response to what they were hearing. Like, when they would play live after that album was released, people were like, oh, I thought you were going to be heavier because you had the drummer from The Crucified and you were immortal. So what is this? And so I think it was a little bit was like, you want to see heavy? We can be heavy. And that's kind of part of what was happening with this album.
Interesting. Okay. And The Blamed is also associated with Left Out, right?
Yeah. And we'll talk about that at the end too. But yes, Brian has had his hand in a ton of different bands, and I'm sure we're not going to do him credit. I'm sure we're going to miss a few, but yes, lots of stuff.
Okay, cool. All right, so how did this come into your life?
This was tough because this is one of those bands I feel like I've always listened to and known about. But I'm going to take a stab. I think maybe the first time I heard this or heard them was on the Noise Volume 1 sampler that came with this magazine called This Prophecy. And I picked up an issue of HM, which used to stand for Heaven's Metal, probably when I was like 14, not because I liked metal at the time. I was kind of like, metal. But I think they had an interview with poor old Lou, mm-hmm. who we've talked about before on this podcast that I really liked. So I was like, huh. And in the back, there was an ad that said something like Jesus, Noise, and Boards. And I was like, there's a Christian skateboarding magazine? Sign me up. So I somehow got a subscription, probably without ever looking at the magazine, sent away for it. And they sent out this sampler CD, which ended up being like a really early Tooth and Nail sampler, and the Blamed was on that.
That's Noise with a Z.
Yes, yeah. N-O-I-Z-E. I don't know that I particularly liked that Blamed song that was on the sampler, but I think that's the first time I heard them.
Okay.
And then I think this album came out as Tooth and Nail was kind of ramping up. You know, it's early 95. They're really kind of releasing a lot of stuff that year. And I think I picked this up sometime that year, probably not when it first came out, but it was more just like, oh, cool, something on Tooth and Nail. This cover looks really cool. I don't know what it is. I'm just going to get it. It was kind of one of those purchases. Yeah. So there we go.
It's pretty iconic cover.
Yeah, yeah. And, I was only looking at like Christian bookstores at the time, but this is something that would like stand out. Like, oh, this is cool looking. So I'm sure it was the combination of Tooth and Nail, cool cover, and it being one of the only things that looked like that at the Christian bookstore. So I bought it.
Okay. So you said this made you feel tough at the time. Why is that?
I think because at the time it was by far the heaviest music I had. I think this album is somewhat, it's definitely heavy, especially with the vocals, but it's, in my opinion, fairly accessible, more so than some other bands that might have like a similar vocal style. So I liked it and kind of latched onto it and was like, oh man, this is like, again, I'm using the word tough because it just felt tough and strong and like, oh, now, Jay, you've really turned a corner. Now you're listening to some really cool, heavy stuff. Like you feel, I don't know who I wanted to be respected by, but somehow feeling like, yes, this is much more respectable. This is heavy. All right. You've made it somewhere in life.
Me personally, I didn't listen to this. I heard this album, but I didn't listen to this because I felt very untough at the time because I didn't like this harder side of punk. And for a long time, I have to say, when I was young, I felt very self-conscious about that. I don't know who I was trying to impress either, but I did.
Well, that's kind of interesting because in some ways I think, and we're going to talk more about it, but I think this album reveals a lot just about like the Christian mentality at the time. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, and in some ways, this music is like the perfect medium for that version of Christianity, unfortunately. Yeah. And so it's probably a good thing you didn't feel that way in some ways looking back, but we'll get to that more.
All right. Do you have any memories that stand out from this album?
Just the only memory I have is actually I introduced a friend to this, and this is a friend who was not into heavier music, like really into like top 40 regular radio, like pop stuff, and for some reason he loved it. Like I still cannot I don't know why, but he really, really liked this album, got it, was just like into any other band that sounded like this for some reason. Again, I think it's heavy, but it's got a lot of melody to it. It just caught on with people, or at least with me and him.
I gotta disagree with that melody thing, but okay. and this friend went on to like other things. Like, did they get into other Tooth and Nail stuff, or was it just
some? Surprisingly, I tried to get him to like Sometimes Sunday's Drain, and he was not into that. Even though they scream on that, but that's much more kind of sludgy and slow. Mm-hmm. And I don't know. It just really, this album really clicked with him. So,
all right. So before going back and listening again, did any songs stand out from your memories?
Yeah, because to be honest, I have revisited this.
Okay.
Since that time, definitely it is something that I would put on. Like, I like to listen to fast music when I'm driving, so maybe if I'm driving or something like that, or some other time, maybe if you're working out, like when you want fast music, I would go to this sometimes. So I remembered quite a few of these, like Just Because, Weakness, the starting song, Feeding the Ignorant, like they cover the crucified guy in the suit and the Pope. I remember that. Like, I pretty much remember the whole album.
Let's dive in with the first song, Feeding the Ignorant.
So one thing I did upon re-listening this is I went to the last bit of Walkabout from 21, which is, they have the Ballad of the Blamed as the last song on there, but it's slow and acoustic. So I did the last, you know, kind of proper Blame song on there and listened to the ending of that and then pulled this up. And it's, I mean, it's like within about 2 seconds, you realize this is almost a completely different band. You know, the vocals are different. It's louder. The production value is a lot better. And this just kind of like riffs and starts right into it. I think I timed there's a guitar riff for 1 second, and then these blistering drums and vocals just come like. Straight in. And so this album has a lot of, like, in my opinion, lyrics you can't really understand unless you're looking at the lyric sheet, but then there's other points in songs where you can like make it out. So I love when I hear Jeremy screaming like, wake up, wake up, and then everything cuts out except for the guitar, and then it just goes right back into it. I think this whole song is under 2 minutes long.
Yes.
You know, you've got the gang vocals, Feeding the Ignorant, that keep saying that. I feel like Jeremy shows off a lot of his vocal talents just even on this first track. He's kind of all over the place. Like, he even sounds kind of death metal-ish when he says, "You deceive." And he spits out the vocals so fast. Like, when I listened to this again with the lyrics, I was like, oh, he's actually really saying that. It's not like the Dakota Motor Company song where it's clearly, like, they're not saying it. He's really saying it, but I had to have the lyric sheet to get some of these because it's just so fast. And just a couple other impressions of the song. Like, it's kind of got, like, about two-thirds of the way, it's kind of got, like, a breakdown in it. And you hear that in quite a few of these songs, kind of more metal influence
very much so.
It's honestly, it's not my favorite song on the album, but it's a good way to start it off because it's just like, you know, full speed immediately.
I agree with that. It is a good I didn't particularly like most of this, but I think this is a good starting song. Part of my notes of I did my interpretation of this song, and I have ra 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 and and jur and things like that written down.
Fair. I wasn't sure this was going to be the album you loved, but you know, appreciate you going through it with me. So So I want to get into the lyrics because honestly, that's what I want to talk about a lot. On this album, because I was surprised when I really took the time to dig deep really what the lyrical content was. Again, this is an album that on a lot of songs you can make out parts of them and, you know, you kind of sing them along or whatever because it's just these little short snippets, but a lot of the stuff is hard to make out until you dig in. But I'm curious, this is your first song basically you're listening to off this. Any other thoughts you had before we do the lyrics?
That part that you mentioned where, you know, everything drops out except for the guitar, I think is the only time that there was any, like, discernible texture to the guitar in the entire song. Other than that, it's just, well, we'll get to it later. Because I think on the next song or the one after that, I have, like, a really, it's when I really started to break down my thoughts on the music itself.
But if you compare this to 21, the production is like
The production is much better on this.
Yeah.
I like the vocals better on 21.
Oh my goodness.
And I think that's the same vocalist that's in Left Out.
Although the guy from 6 Feet Deep also sang in Left Out, who also was in Branston, which is weird.
Interesting.
Yeah. That's what I'm within. Well, so let's go to the vocals on this, though. So you do not like Jeremy Moffat's vocals. That's like what I feel like makes this album. I love the vocals on this.
Really?
Yes.
So, I hate the vocals. So, like, I don't love the guitars, and we'll get into that in a minute, but I hate the vocals. I feel like he's always singing from, like, the back, like, the bottom back of his throat. Like, I don't know how to explain that other than that. Like, there's no, and I get into this more, and this ends up being a big conclusion of mine at the end of the album, but there's no, like, treble to his voice. It's all just like rah 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 rah. Like, right? There's nothing up here. It's all rah 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 rah.
But it's not like as deep or guttural as like death metal.
No, yeah, it's not.
Yeah.
It's just rah, right?
So would you have preferred something like Striper, like some kind of high, like?
No.
Okay.
I'm not saying that. I'm saying that by having no like trebleness to it, there's nothing changes.
Okay. All right.
There's very little texture. I think on the next song, I describe it as there's wall of sound, right? And punk is wall of sound. You know, back to the Ramones, they used distorted guitars because they wanted to create the same like wall of sound, right?
Yeah.
But that wall shouldn't be a flat wall. It should have texture to it, and it like there should be doors in it and windows and things like it shouldn't just like be a flat concrete wall.
Okay.
That's my thoughts on this music.
Interesting. Okay, I would argue there's lots of dimensions to it, but okay, all right. Well,
now,
go ahead.
You told me to go back and listen to it while driving and very loud, and I did that.
Okay, better?
Better, yes.
Okay.
You do pick up on more things when it's turned up really loud. but still, in the end, it's just like, I don't know. Yeah. And it may just be a particular out of me, because, like, in fact, after I listened to this, when I was driving, it was for a long drive. I immediately turned on a playlist that someone sent me with for some various shoegaze bands. And what stood out to me is just the songs I love on that shoegaze playlist after listening to this were kind of these sensory assault trebleness.
Hmm.
Like, yeah. And I've actually explained this before when we did Bloodshed. Because that first EP for Bloodshed sounds like, and I think I said this at the time, it sounds like all the amps are Mesa Boogies, which have a very like low growly. They have no mids and people usually turn off the highs. And so they're very just like very smooth distortion. And there's a lot of bass to the sound. In fact, in the thank yous for this album, they thank Mesa Boogie. So I assume they're using Mesa Boogie amps.
Right.
Right. Whereas the second Bloodshed album or second Bloodshed EP has more of a Marshall-y sound, which has more mids, more treble. And there's also this very distinct sound that you hear with Marshall amps, especially the JCMs, where there's like this mid hiss that kind of is there a lot. And I don't know, I like that sound, I think, because I find this very texturally boring.
I mean, I could see that music-wise. It's definitely got just a lot of like chugga-chugga guitars and fast.
Yeah,
it's just,
yeah.
Lyrically, I'll say this is a song I had never really like examined that closely. and I'm curious your take on a lot of these lyrics, but this one was weird because he uses you, and I've determined I think he's speaking to three different people, like different times when he uses you.
Right?
Like, it threw me for a loop. I was like, wait a minute, I need to go back.
And this isn't the only song where that happens.
Yeah, yeah, it's kind of loosely using it, and you have to be paying attention to what he's doing. And I, by the way, I couldn't figure out who writes the lyrics. I assumed it's Jeremy just because in some of the songs it flows pretty well with the space and the music. Mm-hmm. So it makes sense that only the vocalist is probably writing them the way he's got them fit in. But I don't know. Right. It doesn't say. So it could be Brian. No idea.
Right.
I'll just to read a few. It says the song starts off, and you probably can't understand this until you read the lyrics, but it says, stripping the truth, dressing the lies, made so pretty you can't deny, signing the checks with more percent. When do you lose your mind? See the dreams and diamond rings. They're not that hard to see. Wake up. That's the part you can understand. Wake up, mm-hmm. wake up. Which I assume maybe he's singing to like a fellow musician, maybe about like, you know, royalty checks or like getting bigger fame.
That makes more sense with the more percent thing, because I was very confused about that. Sign the checks with more percent. That line confused me.
That was my guess. And then he's saying stuff like, you don't know the truth. You cannot see numbing. Can't feel the pain. There's no truth, no reality. And then it's like tearing away from God, the Holy One, the Son of God, and moves into gang vocals where they're all saying, feeding the ignorant. Mm-hmm. And so, like, I guess, and you're going to see this all throughout the album, but for them, the truth in reality is God, and everything else is not. And if the person doesn't know the truth, the blamed does. Like, there's a ton of certainty on this album about what is and isn't truth. Like, there's no ambiguity anywhere. And if you're doubting, that's what Satan's using against you. And we'll get to that in some more of these songs. But he, so the, when it moves into the breakdown, there's this weird moment where I guess Jeremy is addressing Satan, because it says, you deceive, slitting at the throat when they can't see, helpless and blind to you, lying, deceiving, what are you doing?
Is it slitting at the throat?
I thought that's what it said. Now, I'm looking at the lyric sheet. Like, yeah. What do you think it was saying?
Because that word in the lyric sheet, you can't tell what he's saying when he's singing it. And that I got sitting. I don't know.
Well, yeah, could be.
Yeah, it's very hard to read in the lyric sheet.
And then it shifts again, and it's kind of like the last part addresses God, I guess, because he says, your truth will crush the skulls of those who hate you. Without a sound, death will come. And then it ends with, your wings will cover me, your wings will cover me, which is from Psalm 91, which I could always make that part out, and I thought that was cool. I liked that part of the psalm, and so that was a part I hung on to, but like... But I mean, if you're saying, your truth will crush the skulls of those who hate you, like, what does that mean for the poor musician he addressed at the beginning of the song? And also, like, why is anyone going to want to come to this type of God if he's, you know, a skull crusher?
Yeah, not inviting. I guess to not get your skull crushed?
Yeah. Well, and maybe that, because you're going to see that in some other songs. Like, they're, in one thing I is, was really interesting coming back to this album was that this is not a God of love they're talking about on this album. I think it might mention God's love once, but it doesn't, at least to me listening to it now, I'm like, that's not what we're highlighting.
Yeah. And there's, you know, I assume we'll talk about it later on, you know, but there's a page in the album. Sorry. It's actually the back of the CD, right? Like behind the CD. And it says, for you, in most cases, I have a tendency to be wrong. I want to express that I love someone in, and there's a bunch of stuff that scratched out, and then it says, in sin. And they are and they are wrong, the sins, I assume. Insensitivity is too easy. Insensitivity is too easy. I want to say that again. Insensitivity is too easy, this song. And then it says, in quotes, I want to hate you, end quote, is as bad as actually hating someone. God is love.
So he does say God is love there. I think he's talking about that song For You, which we'll get to in a minute.
Okay.
Because in that song he says, I hate you. And I think he's trying to say, by the way, I don't hate them. You know, anyway, we'll get there in a minute. But
that contrasted with this song of...
Yeah.
Insensitivity is too easy, but your truth will crush the skulls of those who hate you.
Right. Right. I feel like this song does set some kind of themes for the album, because here's what you're going to see. You're going to hear the blamed knows the truth, which is God. Mm-hmm. That also means others don't know the truth. There's kind of like a literal devil who's looking to deceive and pull people away from God in this. Like, you see that in various songs, like an actual kind of real being.
Yeah, and especially in Second Minded Friend.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm glad you wanted to do that one, because
Yeah.
And God is strong and aggressive, but the blender on his side, so everything's good.
Yeah.
You know. So
anyway. Yeah, and I don't have a lot of commentary about this just because it's a very straightforward song.
Yep.
Yeah. It is what it says, and it's...
Oh, and just the title, Feeding the Ignorant. Like,
right.
I feel like that goes with it too. Like, people are that don't know God are ignorant.
Right. So people who don't know God are ignorant, and people who produce entertainment for them or music for them are feeding the ignorant.
Could be, yes.
That ties into your is he talking to a musician thing.
Right.
Let's move on to the next song then, Weakness.
I like how this follows the first song because it does not slow down at all. Mm-hmm. Like, it's like three little cymbal hits and then it's back up to revved up guitar. And it's just like so fast. I love how Jeremy's vocals come in. Like, you can kind of make these out. He's just like, he says rage and he says the fight for one's soul, the power to control. And he kind of seesaws back and forth then with the next, like, weakness, failure, beaten, loser, like the way he kind of says those lines.
I really like that part. That was the only part of the song that really stood out to me.
Yeah, so he does some cool stuff like that on some of the songs. That's why I think it had to have been him writing the lyrics. Because it just fits with that music too well. Again, it stops and has a guitar riff. And it has a breakdown, like, really early in the song. Mm-hmm. Kind of like with the drums.
A lot of toms.
Yeah, riffs. And then kind of like, he says, a life under grace, fulfill the things that you feel, realize, don't justify every sin that is real. Stops, moves back into a guitar riff, then the drums come in, and it goes right back to faster stuff. So, you know, he says, watch your back, the things you say, the life you live is subject to one, which is an interesting way to talk to people, like, watch your back, because God's watching. But there was a really cool gang vocal part in this that I liked, with the gang vocals coming first. So they would say, like, flee from sin, Jeremy would say, and then now, as the gang vocals say, and then start today, and then rise in Christ, live to die.
And I didn't realize until I went back and looked at the vocals, but when they do the rise part, you know, the gang vocals scream rise really quick, like they do with all of them, rise, you know, but and Jeremy comes in with rise as they're saying rise, and I thought that worked really well.
Yeah, it's kind of a cool way to do it, and again, the production is so much better on this album. It sounds nice. He speeds back up again. He says face to fact, and this line wasn't in the lyric sheet, but I'm pretty sure he says, face the facts, the world hates you.
Okay, like, that's what I got too.
A child of God can't live on his own, receive the strength from our Father for eternity. And then he says, live, and then face the struggle. You know, so the song is called Weakness. It's basically about not being weak and sinning, but living the true way God wants you to. But again, when they're telling a person, watch your back, the things you say, the life you live is subject to one. It's just like, don't screw up. God is watching. And it kind of seems more like God is like just the correct God rather than the loving God. Like, it's just his side or else.
Right.
The only other note I made on this is that, like, it really strikes me how much this music fits the message. like, it's tough, it's aggressive, it's kind of almost militant, and that's basically how they're portraying God and Christianity. So yeah, I think
yes.
It wasn't until I broke it down that I even kind of think of this song as differently from the first one, because when you're listening to the album, I mean, it just plows into the song next. If you're not paying a lot of attention, you might not even realize you were on song two, just because right. It goes so quickly.
And that's kind of my experience with the album too, and really a lot of the album. You know, there's very few songs that stand out to me with like catchy parts, right?
Yeah.
So a lot of the album kind of blends together.
Right.
And I think you're right with kind of, you know, the face the struggle, which is the last line of the song, is kind of the thesis statement of this song. And a lot of the song describes that. But given that, why does the song start with rage, the fight for one's soul? Shouldn't that be Christ's fight, not yours? And so why would rage be involved?
Yeah, I was wondering that too. Now, rage sounds super cool when he screams it.
It does.
It really does. And it's a cool way to start, but it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
For what's going on there. Like, struggle, I don't know. There's so many better words, but I guess it needed to be one syllable to really have that nice scream. But you're right. Like, why would it... I don't know. Why would you be angry about it? Yeah, it doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But it sounds cool. That's kind of me on this album a lot of times. It's like, don't like the lyrics. Don't really make sense to me now, but it sounds cool.
Yeah. We're not doing For You because it's a slow song. I don't know if Jay knows that there's actually a faster part in it, but he skipped it because it's a slow song.
Well, also, we couldn't do every song on this album, but sure. I did want to point out... I did, after kind of saying I didn't want to do it, I did want to point out one thing about the lyrics, because it's For You is basically about a friend who doesn't know God and how Jeremy or the Blamed want them to. But basically at the end, it almost sounds like they've given like up on them because this person never comes to God. And like, here's the last lines of For You, just before we go on. It says, run, nowhere to hide, forgotten and left to die. The truth cannot be found, a victim's demise. You're a victim, close your eyes, goodbye. Because I love you, I will not cry for you. And then just keeps repeating, for you, which is the name of the song. Ouch. Like,
what the?
Yeah. Just calling them a victim and kind of being like, I love you, I won't cry for you. Yeah. So anyway. They say love on this album a couple times, but I don't really ever feel it.
No, true. Yeah.
But going to No Difference.
Yes.
It starts off with a bass line, and it kind of goes into another kind of bouncy verse.
Mm-hmm.
And then it goes into the chorus, which is actually finally kind of easy to understand.
Yeah.
Other songs, he says, what have I done? What did I say? What should I change if I'm just like you? And it's back to these bouncy verses. And again, I really like how he kind of fits the lyrics over these kind of like back and forth bass lines. And it really helps distinguish the chorus from the verse.
Yeah.
The biggest thing I've been wondering with this is when I first heard this song way back in the day, I assumed that this song, because it's called No Difference, the message was from kind of, I guess, like a non-Christian's perspective looking at a Christian. Because Jeremy says on a later kind of chorus, what should I do? No difference between me and you. Why be a Christian if I'm just like you?
Right.
But now when I read it, and I've gone back and forth on this even as I was making my notes, now when I read it, it sounds like the song might be about not fitting in with like the overall Christian culture at the time.
Yeah.
Which I feel like probably both of us could relate to a little bit more, because I think even when you listen to any of this type of music, there's always a time in Christian culture where you're like, I don't really feel like I fit in with this.
Yes.
And the song ends with, if you are what a Christian is, then I am too.
Mm-hmm.
But then I thought, well, maybe you could take it the other way. If it's a non-Christian talking to a Christian who's not really acting Christian, then they can say, what's the point of being? Well, I don't know. So I'm curious your take on this, Clifton.
So if you assume that it's a Christian writing the song, it starts off with, your Bible teaches truth and love. your life does not exhibit this, right?
Yeah.
So it sounds like he's talking to a Christian, right?
Right.
But then later on, he says, why should I change if I'm just like you? What should I do? No difference between me and you. Why be a Christian if I'm just like you? So if you assume that he's talking to a Christian and he is a Christian, that the difference between those doesn't make a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But if I like your assumption that he isn't a Christian talking, and that it makes more sense that way. But then the way I took it overall is your interpretation of, I don't feel like I fit in with this kind of Christian culture, right?
Yeah.
And every punk band writes this song, by the way. Every yeah, Christian okay. punk band
That's true. Good point.
Writes this song. and for good reason, because, yeah, I mean, especially, I can't think of there wasn't a cool trend to Christianity in the 90s. That came later, I think, you know?
Yeah.
Probably not until the early to mid 2000s. So anything that anyone exists in at this time, they're definitely not fitting in with the Christian culture if you're part of any kind of counterculture.
So, and again, I could be wrong because it could be from another perspective, because Jeremy does do that, you know, in Second Minded Friend, definitely takes mm-hmm. a different perspective. That's clear.
Right.
So I could be wrong, but if he is like, as a Christian speaking to another Christian and talking about how they don't fit in the Christian culture, then in a weird way, in that last line where it says, you know, if you're what a Christian is, then I'm a Christian too. It's like the blame to make a point that I've kind of been thinking about in a lot in regards to pretty much all these records we've been listening to, is that like, we like to think of all these as being really alternative and different. But in reality, I feel like they're just kind of spouting out the same values of evangelical culture at that mm-hmm. time. And in this one, yeah. it's really clear. It's pretty militant. It's pretty masculine. It's just kind of mm-hmm. tough, aggressive music. And I know I've plugged this before, but I'm going to do it again. If you haven't read that book, listeners, Jesus and John Wayne, I highly advise you to, because it will help kind of make it'll tie it all together a little bit. She talks about music some in there, but not as much, but just about evangelical culture in general and how, you know, we like to think reflecting God, but really it's just reflecting a greater, just like a cultural thing that's mm-hmm. going on. And I think about that with these bands of like, yeah, you know, we're alternative, but it's like, yeah, but the stuff you're really saying and the values you're putting forth, pretty much the exact same as the overall culture at the time. There are some exceptions. I mean, I would even say Luxury, that we just covered recently, is an mm-hmm. exception. But for the most part, they're,
yeah.
you know, right in line with this.
And in a sense, you know, especially between like the first song of this album and the last song of this album, you kind of get everything that you need to know about their kind of stance on things. And in a lot of ways, this is more toxic than a lot, you know, probably even like Newsboys, right? There's not as much machoism. And I am like Newsboys, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. And again, I feel like this music really fits that kind of macho attitude mm-hmm. as much as I love it still, like listening to some of this, it's just when you combine it with the lyrics and that aggression, it just has kind of a certain, I don't know what the right word is, but it takes it away. Maybe that it shouldn't go the ideas and yeah. the theme. So
do yeah. you know, where these guys have like you said, it's hard to figure out who's writing these lyrics, right? So it's hard to say like how these people changed, because we don't know who's writing right. these lyrics.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. So yeah, it's hard to say. I know the Blame's new album is called The Church is Hurting People, which mm-hmm. it, from what I read, Brian said, you could take it two ways. Like it is actually hurting people, or also the church is made up of hurting people, which is kind of clever. But I haven't fully listened to that album enough to know what, you know, what they're kind of saying about things now. But yeah,
I just listened to like the first two or three songs, and it's so far into the album, but it's the church is hurting people.
Okay,
like actively,
right? Yeah, and I think, you know, most people when they step back, and you know, this was like getting close to 30 years ago. This was recorded in 94, so mm-hmm. a lot's changed, but. Whew. I mean, this is just Yeah, I know my my parents at the time did not appreciate the style of music, but I think if they only had the lyrics, they would have been like, "Oh, yep, 100%. This would have been, you know, this is totally accepted in the Christian culture at the time."
Although I would say probably not, because it says the quiet part out loud in a lot in this, you know.
Good point. Okay. Yeah. Good point.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Let's move on to the next song, Just Because.
So I will tell you that if I had to pick like a single from this album, I would probably pick this one.
Yeah. I think I wrote good song. They should put this on a comp.
Oh, nice. Okay. I'm glad we agreed on that one. It kind of has everything that they are in the album. It's short. It's to the point. It's just nice.
Yeah.
I wrote, it has like a blistering guitar opening and the drums come in with a snare roll and it's just so fast and so good. The verse is very fast. I have no idea what he's saying until he slows it down and says, just because, and he'll say that a lot, just because, kind of singing in the song. It has some spoken word on it, which we hear a few other times on this album, but I think this is the first time it happens. And he says, lying on my bed, waiting for something to happen, waiting for the phone to ring or someone to come home. All I wanted was a friend, someone to talk to. And then he goes, and then he starts screaming, never again, can't take this pain, no more, release. I mean, dare I say it, but this is almost emo, just for that, like, 15, 20 seconds.
Yeah, the song kind of is kind of all over the place, right?
Right.
And it's, yeah, and for that, it's a very catchy, it's a very standout song, right?
Yeah.
And It's a very nice song. In fact, one of the notes I made my first listen through was, I wonder if they call this their poppy song.
Right. Because it's got background vocals. It's like,
Yeah, I wrote that too. Holy crap, there's background vocals on this song.
And he's still got the fast vocals some, but he gets a lot slower. He kind of goes back and forth between fast and slow. This song has a little nuance for me because I'm not totally sure what he means by just because he just keeps saying that after stuff. Like, I feel anger just because, you know.
I have thoughts.
Good. The only message, though, I got was kind of like, you know, you could sit around and feel sorry for yourself, even if you don't know why. That might be that kind of just because. But if you do, Satan will get you, so don't do that.
Yeah, the song takes a weird turn.
Right? When he's screaming it, I'll be honest, it sounds cool, at least to me, when I hear it, because he says, Satan's eyes are looking down at you, like screaming it out. Like, sounds cool, but when you start thinking about it, you're like, what?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, do you have any other thoughts on the lyrics? Or
the only other thing I wanted to point out is he says wicked world, which I feel like really tells you a lot about their thoughts on everything, because that comes through in a lot of other songs. Like, the world is wicked, can't trust it. Oh, and there's also a powerful, literal Satan that you need to be worried about. That has already happened in this album. It's coming up again here. You'll see it again.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But those are my main thoughts. Tell me what you kind of got from this.
So at first I thought this was going to be like a I failed and you picked me up kind of song.
I feel like the Breeze, the next song, is kind of more of I fall and you pick me up song. But yeah, this one, I don't know what's going on.
Yeah. So let me give you my interpretation. It's really this song and the next one especially. So it starts off with, I've slipped again on an icy floor. I'm nowhere to be found. It's like being lost far away from home and I cannot get back just because. And so I thought that was going to go into, you know, I failed and you picked me up kind of song.
Sure.
But then there's that whole talking verse that you talked about.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's followed by this really, what I think is a really effective chorus, which is, I feel lost just because. I feel empty just because. I feel anger just because. I want to die just because.
Right.
Which I really appreciate the those lyrics. I think they're really effective. I think they really capture, you know, this feeling. I think that's especially as a teenager, I could really relate to, although I didn't listen to this at the time. If I had heard this song, I probably would. And which brings up the question, Tooth and Nail, why wasn't this on a comp?
Agreed. This should have been pushed more. It's a good song.
Yes. But then we get to the last verse, which, first off, there's a line, there's a word or something missing from the first line because it doesn't make any sense.
I agree. I couldn't figure it out either.
It says can't ripped apart, but I think maybe it means can't get ripped apart. Okay, so let me read it with the get in there. Can't get ripped apart by this wicked world, and I will not follow through. It happened to me, yes, once before, and I was pretty badly bruised. All understandable, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then it changes here. It says, you can have your fun, play your little games, whatever best suits you. Don't be surprised if in the end Satan's eyes are looking down at you. And as you've pointed out, there's a lot of judgmentalness on this album. This song didn't have to be judgmental. This was a good song. And then all of a sudden, in the last two lines, they just throw in some judgmentalness because it was missing? Like, I don't know, right? Like, it could have just been this great, like... Anyways, yeah. So...
You just couldn't leave it alone, you know?
Right.
Just couldn't leave it alone.
And then I got to thinking more, especially in light of the next song. And I don't know if I want to bring this up now or with the next song.
Do you want to jump?
Because it might.
You want to jump?
Let's do the next song. Yeah, let's do the next song because I want to wrap up my interpretation of what's going on between these two songs together.
Okay. So next song is called Breeze, mm-hmm. and it's very different sounding. Like even if you just looking through the album, you would kind of be like, oh wait, it starts off really slow and Jeremy's just singing, and it's really kind of a departure from everything else you hear. And actually on a podcast with Brian, he talked about how, you know, Jeremy actually became the drummer for Stavesacre in their first album. And this, he says, if you think about like Mark's vocals, you know, from Stavesacre, this sounds actually a lot like Stavesacre. And he said, Mark even came in the studio and recorded some background vocals for the song, but they ended up taking them out. So he never got credited, but I was like, oh, it does sound a lot like Stavesacre now that I think about it. You know, so really like a different band for the first couple minutes. Does go from kind of singing to screaming about 50 seconds in, which I think shows his range, which is really good. Mm-hmm. We may disagree, but I think that. But for the first 2 minutes or so, it's kind of like a mid-tempo rock song, which is Jeremy singing and then screaming at a few different parts.
Yeah, and like if Oasis played this song in kind of like with their instruments and their amps and everything, it might sound like an Oasis song.
Yeah, I mean, it's a very different sound for the album. And, you know, it starts off with, he says, waking up on a Saturday afternoon, the clock reads 12:03. And I was like, it's 15-year-old Jay could relate to that a lot because that's about what time I woke up on the weekends. I think he means it more as like a, I have regret, maybe I shouldn't, you know, it's implied at least a little bit from the rest of the song that, you know, maybe he's done something bad. He's thinking back on these things and all that. But before I get too much more into the lyrics, about 2 minutes into this, the song takes a pretty big turn, and it starts building with the drums. You even get a double bass drum, which I think is kind of really the first time we've heard it at least steady on this album, and it sounds very metal. Like, it moves into a very metal-sounding song.
Yeah. And you get like the break these chains, which is a very metal scream.
Which sounds cool. Yeah, it really fits with the song really? The time. And there are moments in this album where I don't necessarily agree with the lyrics, but they sound cool, like with the music at the time. Like, this is one of those moments. Even the Satan's eyes are looking down at you. Sounds kind of cool.
It does.
In the music at the time. Now, yeah, when we dissect it more, it doesn't hold up. But anyway, so yeah, there's a little bit of spoken word where he says, I think he says, I didn't know it would be this way. Fear, trembling. Am I going to die? And then he just starts screaming, break these chains. And then the song slows down again to like a bridge with a really slow guitar solo. Like, like very different from anything else you hear at all on this album. It speeds up again towards the end. There's one last screaming part, and he says, and here I am. And basically at the end, he says, I've been set free. I swear, though, Clifton, you need to do this. When I listen to it, it sounds like he's saying, and here I am, I'm Vincent Price. So just go back sometime. I think you might hear that. I kept like hearing that. I had to look at the lyrics. I was like, why is he talking about Vincent? It's not. I mean, clearly he's saying what's in the lyrics.
I definitely heard I've been set free.
Well, just think about Vincent Price when you listen to it next time.
Okay.
Maybe you'll hear it. But yeah, so let's talk about the meaning. I will say this song is kind of a mishmash of styles, a little bit like the last one. I actually still kind of think it works.
Oh, yeah, because then there's this weird solo towards the end, which does not feel like a hardcore punk
solo. Like, it's just... It's completely
It is so
different.
Weird.
But, I mean, this and the song before, I feel like, kind of work well. In fact, I think they're two of the best songs on the album, just sonically.
Yeah, so. I think these three songs right together are kind of where they hit. They're really the only... There are three of the most interesting songs on the album to me, and there's not very much interesting on this album for me.
Okay. So
before we really dig into the lyrics, I want to mention that the lyric sheet for this song is a two-pager. Like, it's on two pages, and the lyrics are on the left side, and on the right side is a picture of a doorway in black and white, and kind of has a picture of the band kind of superimposed over it. And they have the word free in kind of just loose letters, like typewriter letters, just kind of floating over the picture. It's pretty effective. I like it.
Yeah, I mean, you talk about the end, but I like the layout for this overall, especially considering when it came out.
Yeah. Here's my thoughts.
Okay.
Between this song and the last song, so especially with the, you know, waking up on a Saturday in the afternoon, look at my clock, it reads 12:03. And here I am now looking at me. I've made a mess, a miserable wreck. What have I done? And let's go back to the talking verse on the last song, which was lying on my bed, waiting for something to happen, waiting for the phone to ring or someone to come. And all I wanted was a friend, someone to talk to. So here's my interpretation of this. And maybe it's overreading it, but I have no doubts about this when I was reading it without talking to you.
Okay.
Which was, these are just symptoms of depression and anxiety.
Right.
Okay. And what really struck me on this, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to say this in a way that makes sense to anyone, even though I've tried to think of how to say this. And I've talked about it before, you know, that you know, I wasn't diagnosed with anything until like my mid-20s. But growing up with this, I've always dealt with depression and anxiety. And when you start to interpret that through the lens of Christianity, I feel like very, very weird things happen. And this is what I don't know how to describe exactly, because the world that I was raised in, Jay, the world that you were raised in, is very insular in that you don't have, like, we didn't, depression wasn't a thing. Anxiety was something that you prayed about, you know?
Yeah, true.
It wasn't a medical issue. And for years going through this stuff for me, I was, you know, pushed on to pastors and on to other ministers of like, well, this is a problem of your faith.
Yep.
And when you start interpreting those feelings of loneliness and hopelessness with the Christian lens, it becomes toxic very quickly. If you can imagine that, you know, you are being told that God is love and he brings joy, you know, and these kind of things, and you're like, well, I don't have joy, you know, so.
And
so you interpret that as, well, then I'm being punished for something, or I'm separated from God, or I've messed up, and because it's so insular, because there's not this other framework of, well, let's take God out of this for a second, you know, you start interpreting every little thing as having to do, from this mental illness, as having to do with something that God is doing to you, or things like this. And I think that some of the like toxic judgmentalness of this album comes from that mindset. And this is what I don't know how to describe this, because it's a very dark time of my life that I don't like looking back on, you know?
You've done I'll just butt in and say you've done a really good job though of explaining so far. Like, I'm
okay.
Very much tracking with you. Yeah.
Okay. When you start interpreting these things through that lens, it's not only just toxic. It's not only just it becomes more and more of this little prison. So that the more you interpret this mental illness through this lens, the stronger the prison of this mental illness becomes, because of the interpretation through the lens of Christianity.
That makes sense completely, because you just think, well, God must hate me. I'm still not good enough. Oh my, and it just spirals. I could totally see that.
Exactly. I messed up, you know? And so you start seeing these tiny mistakes as these huge deals.
Hmm.
You know, if you're mad at yourself for making a mistake, inside, if you struggle with depression and anxiety, that snowballs. And the only choice you have is to interpret that as, well, that's the Holy Spirit. It's not depression and anxiety. It is the Holy Spirit. And if other people aren't doing that, well, they must be in the clutches of Satan.
Right. Yeah. That's what I wanted to throw in, too, is when you add in the whole spiritual warfare element, mm-hmm. and a literal Satan and demons and all that. I mean, that's just going to fuck you up even more.
Correct. Like, yes.
Aside, just put the God stuff aside, that you're not making him happy enough, and that's why you feel this way. Now you're being attacked by demons and stuff, and that's why you're feeling this way. Like, ooh, right. that's a lot.
So we've looked at these two songs, but let's go back and look at like the first song, where it's very macho, it's very judgmental, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so that kind of, I think that mindset is a direct result of interpreting this mental illness through the Christian lens, where you have to be macho, you have to be strong, otherwise you're not going to survive this. And if other people aren't being macho and strong enough, they're not going to survive it. So you need to tell them that they need to be macho and strong.
Hmm. It makes a lot of sense. This is not at all to the level you're talking about, but I remember, you know, growing up in this culture, there was always this, you needed to have certainty, and even about mm-hmm. like your salvation. Right. And I remember always thinking like, well, I don't know 100% if I died tonight. Like, you know, but really, I mean, I'm just thinking like, honestly, if I'm being really honest with myself, I don't know. So I pray that prayer like every single time it was brought up, basically. Anytime there's an altar call, I'm sitting there quietly just to myself re-praying it, because there's still this little, because I'm a human, right? And actually I had doubt.
Right.
And that's honestly a good thing, but I wouldn't let myself know that or feel that, and that's the thing, is there's always this, is you have to be certain, it has to be certain, it's just, there's no ambiguity, there's no room for anything mm-hmm. else. Yeah, and I think you're right, that so that gets pushed, because the reality is people are complex, and we do have right. doubts, and we do have anxieties, and that's just normal.
But right,
instead of, and now take with that. It, yeah, it's this.
Take that normal anxiety and add onto it clinical anxiety.
Right.
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 And that is And that's it's a literal beast, right? Yeah, what do you do with that?
Right.
And I'm reminded of, you know, something I heard a long time ago, and I'm not going to mention the source because it's a little bit toxic, but these, you know, the churches that we grew up in that are very fundamentalist, they're not full of healthy people.
Mm.
Yeah. If these people were healthy, they wouldn't be drawn to this.
It's a really good point.
Yeah.
Not to say that I don't love a lot of those people still.
No.
But yeah. Right.
I'm not being judgmental here. I'm saying, and I'm saying this out of empathy, you know, and compassion, is that what we do to each other, what we did to each other, is not okay.
Yeah. 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 Very true.
And then I will say, on top of that, there's a few people that I don't have compassion for, like my former pastor, Robert Jeffress.
Fair.
who are in it for the power, and they just take advantage of that.
Yep.
You know, they are manipulators of that feeling. They're manipulators of that feeling in healthy people, and then in unhealthy people, it is destructive to the core.
Mm.
To the core of that person, I will say.
Yeah. No, I think you did a great job of making all that make sense, and you kind of give me a new lens to view this through, which, in a way, like, kind of segues to the next song
mm-hmm.
we're doing, which I'm glad you wanted to do. Originally, I didn't have this on my list.
Yes, so Second Minded Friend, it's the eighth song on the album.
Yep.
And it's one of the more fun songs musically, I think, and I think, you know, you really like the song Weakness, which is the second song on the album. I think if this had been the second song on the album, I would have liked this album more when I heard it. Just because I think the vocals on this are more interesting.
Because he says there is no God.
No, the vocals, not the lyrics. The little vocals.
I know.
But the lyrics. I don't want to dig into them a lot, but literally my first time after reading them, I was like, whoa. Like, it's let me read the first verse here. I'm your second-minded friend. I'll tell you what you need. I'll give you what you want. I'll give it all right now. I'll give you fortune and fame, a perfect mind and a perfect body, anything to keep you away from God. Listen to my voice. That's what the whole song is about. The whole song is written from like this devil perspective. Like I almost thought of this as like what's that C.S. Lewis book?
Oh, Screwtape Letters.
Yeah, I almost look at this from like a Screwtape perspective, right?
Yeah,
where the whole thing is just like, don't worry, you're going to be successful because I'm trying to keep you from God. Any kind of success is just meant to keep you from God. It's very conspiratorial almost.
Yeah, well, there was, you know, when younger Jay heard this, I definitely did a double take because this part of this song is another one you can pretty clearly make out the vocals. And at one point, yeah, he says, there is no God. He isn't there. This Bible you have on your shelf is just a fairy tale. And I was like, mm-hmm. But then even young Jay was smart enough to figure out what they were doing here. But yeah, it's pretty blatant, like trying to take that point of view, and this is kind of the voices you hear inside your head trying to push you away from God.
Mm-hmm.
My notes on this, I just said this is like a very sure kind of self-righteous Christianity, because
right,
God is truth. The world and Satan will try to pull you away from him. But here's the interesting thing in this one. The lyrics say at one point, they say destruction, whatever it takes, goodness, mm-hmm, wickedness, loving, hatred, freedom, pleasure, riches, poverty, pride, beauty, fame, and life. And I don't really understand how goodness and loving, for instance, could pull you away from God. I mean, in essence, isn't that what God is and supposed to be? So, I'm curious more your interpretation of this song, because a lot of that stuff I was like scratching my head, although I think you've given us a better lens to kind of understand this through.
Right, yeah. Yeah, and I carry that lens over to this song, right? you know, and then the other side of, you know, for me, my struggle with that mental illness, you know, was, of course, there's lots of doubts involved, right? And this song is very telling in that there's no attempt at apologetics here. This is just, oh, you have doubts? Satan.
Yep.
Satan. Be afraid. Like, it's very, I've been listening to the Knowledge Fight podcast, which we had Dan on a while ago. And it's, you know, it's about Alex Jones, and it's very, like, just fear-based. It reminds me of Alex Jones a lot. Just pushing this fear.
Yeah, keep that. Remind me of that when we get to the last song, because I think that kind of ties some of this together.
Yeah.
As well. Yeah, but I guess my thing is, like, even not just fear of feeling like you're away from God, basically even saying, like, if you enjoy life, you're not, like, you're not a Christian. You're not tuned in to God.
No, very precisely. and it goes from anything from doubts to that, right? I'm confusion in your mind. I'm the detour to your sight. I'll fill your ears with future dreams and touch you with my life. I'll take over all your thoughts. I'll blind you with my beauty. I'm your second-minded friend. Anything that keeps you away from God, listen to my voice. Destruction is my goal. Whatever it takes. And then you did the
right, like
goodness, wickedness, all that,
Yeah. I know.
Yeah.
But I think you are right. This album does kind of say the quiet part out loud. And this is a kind of another good example of just like, oh, yep, okay. This is what they really believe.
Yeah. And it's just that very kind of hard-minded, you know, macho-ness of Christianity. And of that, and I think it's very, very much not just Christianity, because there's all kinds of Christianity, but of that very specific evangelical, you know, conservative Christian evangelical Christianity.
Right.
Yeah.
Where again, I'm sure if you asked the Blamed at the time, and definitely as a fan of them, we didn't think that we like fit in that world.
Mm-hmm.
But this is 100% like in that world. You know,
yes.
this is it in a nutshell.
Well, because even at that time, I Screwtape Letters was, Screwtape Letters to me was like, oh, we don't talk about this in church, you know, like,
yeah.
it was almost like an alternative lifestyle to read Screwtape Letters, you know, like that was what we considered alternative was, oh man, this guy was an Episcopalian, you know? Yeah. It's just this very weird, he wasn't Episcopalian, wasn't he? He was Anglican, but
well, that's yeah. It's basically the same thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And I said earlier, you know, how just insular that life was growing up in the church like that, to the extent that C.S. Lewis is alternative, you know,
right.
is finding a little secret.
Good point. Yeah.
When these days there's nothing like more quintessentially evangelical American Christianity than, even though he's British, you know, it just still has that same mindset, that very like hard nosed, you know, you can't tell me anything different because I already believe this kind of thinking.
Yeah.
And I almost describe this song as presuppositionalist, which is an approach to apologetics, but it is that very much like, I already assume I'm right. So you better have a, you know.
Right. Yeah. No, this whole album, definitely, there is no questioning on this. They're right. Definitely right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, speaking of that, and I know we didn't officially say we wanted to do this song, but can we talk about Guy in a Suit and the Pope just for a minute? So they cover the Crucified song, Guy in a Suit and the Pope, and it's actually the same drummer, because Jim Chaffin was in the Crucified, and even in the liner notes, they're basically like, we're the Crucified now, because, I don't know, I guess they're just wondering who's going to be the next Crucified. And it's,
that's actually in the liner notes, too.
Yeah, so I like this song. As far as sonically, I liked the Crucified version. I liked this one. I don't know which one I think is better. And part of it, I think both of us probably still really agree with. Like the first, it's just, I like the way that vocals come in. I like the way it starts. And the first few lines are, Mr. Preacher on the TV screen tells me that he knows just what I need. He's been there before and back again. But with that fancy suit, I find him hard to believe. Okay. I think pretty much everyone listening to this podcast is like, yep, I get that. I understand that. But then it gets a lot more like, yeah, they're very sure of themselves, let's say. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're talking about the Pope, the second time about Pope John and saying basically the same thing about him, which I don't know why evangelical Christians always hate the Pope, but that's some theme throughout Christianity.
It's a long history.
But it, and again, I kind of have fond memories of the song because I like the crucified version too, but when you really start to think about the lyrics, yes, nobody likes these TV preacher evangelists. Yes, we know they're out for money, all that stuff. The Pope, I feel like, is more, that's a lot more debatable, but it's basically just like...
Because popes change.
Right, exactly. And it's basically just like, we figured it out. They haven't. Our version of Christianity is true. I don't know. It's just this they're so sure of themselves in this.
Yeah.
You know?
There's a line, the second verse says, preacher, and in parentheses it says, Pope John, second verse.
Because the second time they say, first time they say, preacher, time will come, da-da-da-da, and the second time they say, Pope John, time will come, da-da-da-da. Yeah.
Do they mean Pope John Paul?
Yeah. Because at the time, he was still Pope, I believe.
Yes, he was, yeah.
Right. Which, honestly, you could do a lot worse than, like,
yes,
Pope John Paul. So it's kind of like, yeah. But anyway.
Like the Nazi one we had after that.
Right. So it's just, I don't know. It's funny that they picked that song to cover because it totally fits exactly with everything else they're doing on this album.
Yeah.
And again, it tries to seem edgy because it's kind of critiquing aspects of Christianity, but in reality, it's just revealing that it's kind of the same thing.
Yeah, it's just their, which once again reminds me of this Alex Jones thing, right? It's like this cry for freedom, but what they really mean, and this goes back to the Puritans and the settling of America, you know, it's like they cry for freedom, but what they really mean is, I want to do it my way, and you're going to do it my way too.
Okay, then let's let that thought take us to the last song I want to talk about, because it fits. So the last song is called Declaration Dead. And I will say, for some reason, I never really listened to this song that much. I honestly don't think it's that good of a song, just musically. So I think I always listened to that Crucified cover and then just kind of was like, meh, skip this.
Mm-hmm.
But it is the final song on the album. I saw there's a clip. There's like only one clip out there, I think, of this version of The Blamed. They're playing at Cornerstone 95. It's on YouTube, and it's about 20-ish minutes long, and I think this is the first song they play there. Like, I think this is like an important song for them, I'll say, or at least at the time, right? So it starts with a guitar, and it's got spoken word, and it says, a declaration written to free the hearts and souls of those who sought after God, to give hope. I'm like, okay, you know, this sounds all right, but then it gets bad and goes south really, really quickly. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Yeah, where to even start?
I was looking for like the eye roll emoji putting on my keyboard. I don't know why that's not part of like the standard English keyboard, the eye roll emoji. It was just, yeah.
I feel like this song kind of definitely helps unlock a lot of the other stuff on the album. Like if this had been first, you would have been like, oh, like everything would have made sense even quicker, you know?
Yes.
Because it basically says, where was it? Rights to worship the one who set them free. And basically, here's how it goes. It says, taken from our schools, taught to believe lies, okay, alternative lifestyles, our declaration dead. Lying, hatred, power, control, weakness, reject, mindless products, hopeless, freeless, lifeless soul. Our government has made our children, our children are lied to.
Our government has made us objects.
Thank you. Our government has made us objects. Our children are lied to every day by the schools and government rotting away, taking our facts about our fathers who trusted in our Lord Jesus Christ. This country was founded on his word. By his mighty hand, he conquered all. Don't you forget, in God we trust, but we've left him, we've left him, we've left him. This could be Carmen. Like, this this is basically Carmen that we love to make fun of, but this is really the exact same thing.
This, you're right, this absolutely... Especially with the spoken word thing, this is absolutely Carmen.
Yeah, like, this is... Oh my gosh, I'll just read the rest because you might as well hear it. It says, saved, the blood of Christ cleans me. Power from Yahweh who will strengthen you. Standing firm upon the word of God. Rebuke false teachers and their ministries. Well, there's that reference to the song before. When he says, this country was founded on the Christ and quickly forgot him. Turn from your wicked ways and repent of your sin. Stand in Christ on the rock and rise in unity. You call yourself a Christian, but can people see Christ in you? We've left our God. I mean, this song is straight up Christian nationalism. Mm-hmm. This is really the blame. This is really what you want to leave people with?
Things with?
like last song on the album?
Yeah.
You know, and they'll say, you call yourself a Christian, but can people see Christ in you? Like, that sounds good, but what you really mean is just one specific interpretation of this. There's nothing about loving others anywhere through this, or any of the main things Jesus even talks about.
There's nothing New Testament about this.
Yes.
This is that typical American evangelical looking at, you know, Judah and Israel and saying, we're the new Israel.
Yeah.
That's all this is, you know? Yeah.
Taking,
and you're right, it's Christian nationalist. One of my notes is, are these guys still dominionists?
Right. Taking out facts about our fathers, I mean, they're meaning founding fathers, who trusted in our Lord Jesus Christ, his country was founded on his word. Like, no, it wasn't!
Yeah.
This is not,
My other note is, hi, my name's David Barton.
Yeah.
I've come to tell you the hidden truth about the founding of our once great nation.
Exactly! Like, oh my gosh, this is so... It's just, you're right, it's the quiet part out loud on this album, and this is just so in your face with just all the stuff that is a little bit more hidden behind the curtain in other artists or just teachings or ministries. Yes. This is just straight out there.
But this is also kind of part of the turning point. You know, starting with the moral majority in the late 70s, there was that push for conservative evangelical Christians to take over kind of the government, you know, in a very nationalist way, right? And today, it's kind of out in the open. But this was kind of that turning point phase, you know, where it went from being very behind the scenes to kind of coming out in the open, like, especially with Carmen and things like that, where we started saying these things out loud. We started saying, oh, no, this has always been a Christian country. You know, we stopped being Christians, like, the day after, you know, we signed the Declaration of Independence. Well, I don't know what they think happened, you know, but they're invented history. But it's... Yeah, this is at that turning point in culture. The 90s are, especially the mid-90s, are that time when it went from being very underground till we actually started talking about it out loud.
There's a mini-series on Netflix that you just made me think of called The Family. It's worth watching. I think it came out a couple years ago, and it's basically about how some people, they actually do the National Prayer Breakfast, this kind of group that started pushing that, kind of really started coming into being around the same time you're talking about. And the kind of whole idea was like, well, God wants us in powerful positions, so let's like rub elbows with people who are in power. And so they set up those kind of things. And just my point of view, how twisted some of this stuff got, but you can see it in this song and a lot of the other things at the time. Yeah, I will say, this album has been tough for me because I still love a lot of the music and have a lot of fond memories of it. But man, dissecting it with these lyrics made me really look at it in a new way and just kind of like,
this, wow. This is harder than 121 to get over.
Yeah. It's very like, to me almost more than, and I feel like I keep saying this, almost more than any other album we've covered, but like for this one, it just really is speaking the language of the time very clearly. We just did Black Eyed Siva was our one before this. And like, that's got a lot of this in there too, but not as in your face. Like this is just, and the music helps this, unfortunately. Like it just kind of that militant masculine, the music completely fits in with the message of the lyrics. So
very true.
Yeah, even though I love it, yeah, it's bad.
And Black Eyed Skiva, because you can understand the lyrics, had to be more artful, right? Whereas these guys, since they're just screaming, they can kind of just be more direct.
Yep.
So what are your overall thoughts on the album today?
Just that I love the sound. There are still some songs I'm definitely going to continue to listen to.
Mm-hmm.
And you can probably tell by the ones you covered, I kind of really more like the first half of the album, probably more than I do the second. But I love how aggressive it is. But woo, now that I'm more listening to what's actually being said and the message behind it, yikes.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, for me, like I enjoy hardcore punk, even though I probably thought I didn't to a large extent this time, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But really what I'm not liking is that it's literally just that lack of treble. It really just comes down to that. There's like no treble builds texture. And when there's a lack of treble, there's a lack of texture to me. And I also don't like the vocals. I think the vocals are a little too metal influenced for me.
Yeah, you're not really a metal guy.
No. Metal is my least favorite thing ever. Yeah. Yeah. Isn't that what punk is for? Wasn't you know, punk partly a rejection of metal? I understand why people like this. I just, for me, it lacks a little something, you know? And it really, and like I said, I was kind of self-conscious of this at the time, that I didn't like this heavier stuff, but it is just that lack of trouble. Because there were other things I liked, right? I liked, you know, I liked 121. That's pretty hard. Left Out is more of a pop punk. It has a lot of the hard elements, but it is more pop punk.
It's definitely more melody. Yeah.
Right. I like melody too, right? Like, I like Crux. I think they have a little bit more melody, too. They also just have way more treble. I sent you a song from a band called Tendril off of the Underground 101 compilation. And, you know, it's hard like this, but it has treble to it, and it gives everything texture. What do you think about the artwork?
I kind of love it. I know it's of the time, but I think it looks really...
Yeah.
Really nice. I still don't know exactly what that is. It looks like kind of it's over somebody's tattooed back, possibly as a background, or it's just some like weird wallpaper or something.
Well, I think it's a wireframe of something.
Right. It's just some kind of twisted wireframe.
Yeah.
But it's kind of an artsy photo, but it looks cool. And I don't know. I still think it looks kind of nice.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. The Blamed, like the lettering for The Blamed, is like this very typical.
Yeah.
Like 90s.
Font. Lowercase, of course, right? Yeah.
But then there's like this typewriter font with red X's behind The Blamed, and that happens every time they repeat the word the band name The Blamed on this album, in the art. And it's, I don't know, it's effective. Like it's very corny when you start to analyze it, but it works. Like I don't know why.
Yeah, I mean, I think the whole packaging is honestly pretty cool.
Yeah,
it's obvious that Tooth and Nail at the time had more money to spend on this one than the first one. The first one, I think, is just like two pages kind of thing. This one is multiple pages stapled together, multiple colors, like spent a lot more time on graphic design on this one. Mm-hmm. Some of it's cool, some of it's just weird. But yeah.
For the lyric sheet, every song at least gets its own page, possibly a full like bifold, you know?
Yeah. No, I think overall it's pretty cool. Like, they had nice layout. I'm not sure, does it say who did the layout on this? Layout and art production, Doug McFerrin and Matt Wignall. Matt is the guy from Javelina Rail Company who did a bunch of the Tooth and Nail stuff, but I don't know who the guy is.
Yeah,
but it works well. Like, I think it's honestly pretty nice packaging and layout.
Agreed. I mentioned before that they think both Marshall, they think Gibson and Mesa Boogie in the thank yous, as well as like POD, all the Tooth and Nail bands, JPUSA, just so many bands, Mortal, 6 Feet Deep, Crash Dog. They say Crash Dog for stealing our sound. Circle of Dust, Ronnie Martin.
Yeah, so Gary the bassist thinks Weezer, but it's spelled Weazer.
I made a note of that.
And then he also thinks
the NRA.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Oh.
Yeah, interesting. Well, yeah,
it kind of fits.
That Weezer spelt wrong is weird. Like, was there actually a band with that spelling of Weezer, or?
No idea.
Yeah, so yeah, as you mentioned, they claim to be the next Crucified.
Right.
They also think Crucified on here, which they say, open your eyes, we're the Crucified. You know, that's what you said. Then they say Then they also think Chasm, which they call the next crucified.
Which Chasm was on Boot to Head, but I don't know that they did much, so I don't think that one was true.
Okay. But,
oh well.
Yeah. They also think Gene, which I assume is Gene Eugene, because wasn't he in Crash Dog?
No, he was in Adam again, but he had his hand in all this stuff, so I'm sure it's him.
I read somewhere that he had something to do with this album. I don't know.
I'm sure he did.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I just want to say recording quality. I don't have credit for this. I copied this from the Crindy 95 essay on this album. If that's a fun website to look at. Just Google Crindy, Crindie 95. I think it's on Medium. And in 2015, people kind of did a 20-year retrospective on a lot of the interesting kind of indie Christian albums that came out at the time. And this guy, Alan Parrish, wrote one for this album. And he did, it sounds like he interviewed Brian Gray a little bit for it. He says, as Gray explains, Jeremy Moffat was 10 times the singer I was. We wanted to make a more intense record. We did a 4-song demo at Randy Rose's studio, and that was Jeremy's intro to the band. The Blame recorded Frail in 5 days with Mark Rodriguez producing. Gray continues, he, meaning Rodriguez, is a secret weapon to how amazing that record sounds. He was the touring sound guy during my tenure in Mortal. I'm a pretty sloppy guitarist. Jeff Ballou was hanging out during that session, and I still believe he re-recorded my tracks after I left the studio each night because he's the cleanest and tightest guitar player I know. And Ballou, of course, was the bass player in the Crucified and went on to be the guitarist in Savesaker. So I think this album sounds really good, especially considering it was recorded in late 94, and especially when you compare it to their album before. It's kind of like...
Yeah, it's a big departure. Day.
Yeah. One other thing I found online, it looks like this album was originally going to be called Entropy, because there's some early promo materials on the band's website now, even, that you can see, that refer to, there's like a promo poster that talks about Entropy, their second album, but
yeah.
Later they changed it to Frail. Frail is definitely a better name for it than Entropy. I'm not sure why they were considering that one.
I don't think either of them are particularly good.
No, they don't really fit. It's just, you know, three syllables, I don't know, it doesn't sound, the Blamed Entropy, the Blamed Frail, it just sounds better to me. But neither one necessarily really fit with what's going on here.
So Jay, tell us, where are they now?
Okay, well, Brian Gray is going to be easy to tell you, because that one's easy to find. The other guys, I'm going to apologize, I don't know a lot. So Jeremy Moffat, who really, in my opinion, kind of makes this album, like, it just sounds so different with his vocals, and I think he probably, I'm going to guess he's the one that wrote the lyrics, although I don't know. He left the Blame to play drums for Stavesaker. He was the drummer on their first album, Friction. And then after that, it's really unclear what happened to him. There's a few rumors on a message board that I don't really want to give credit to because I don't know for sure. But even that doesn't give me very much. In an interview with Brian Gray, he basically said Jeremy just seems to have dropped off the face of the earth. Like, nobody knows really where he is or what he's doing. So if anybody out there knows, we'd love to hear. Because again, Clifton doesn't, but I love the vocals on this album and would love to hear like Jeremy singing with the Blamed again. So, you know, after this album, Brian Gray, at some point, I think not too long after, moves to Chicago and joins Japuza, which is Jesus People USA. They're the group that puts on Cornerstone, that did put on Cornerstone every year. And I think they didn't put out anything until 1998. They put out another album called Again. And I think from what I read, Brian was even flying up like Jim and some other musicians to Chicago to play with him on those albums. They put out another one called Forever in 1999. Both those albums kind of have this same hardcore punk sound. It's not, to me, it's not as metal sounding as this, but kind of hardcore punk. After that, they kind of take another change, and Brian ends up just working with Chicago people from Japuza with him. So he gets, and I apologize, I'm going to butcher these last names, but he gets Christopher and Trevor Witala and Matt Swite. Sorry if I'm mispronouncing them. But they kind of form like a new version of the Blamed in like early 2000. And they release kind of an EP called Germany, an album called Isolated Incident. And those are all on Gurr Records, which is kind of the imprint of Japuza. But in 2002, they moved back to Tooth and Nail and released an album called Give Us Barabbas, which is really worth listening to because it sounds completely different than this. Like, you know, 21 sounds different from Frail. I would say Give Us Barabbas sounds even different than, like, both of those. Like, it's much more post-punk maybe a little more like indie kind of that vibe, less like less in your face kind of sounding. Worth checking out because it's just such a change. I don't think The Blamed did too much else really after that until 2019. They released a whole new full album called The Church Is Hurting People, and Jim Chaffin returns on drums for that one, and they've got a guy named Sid Dufour and Jeff Locke also joining the band. One cool thing about the band is they're still pretty active on Facebook, so check out their Facebook page, and they also have a website, theblamedband.com. You can even order t-shirts and get their new album and stuff. And we briefly talked about this. Brian also kind of started the band Left Out, like sometime back in 96 when, I don't like, this guy's in all kinds of music. I don't know how he has time for all this, but he started Left Out with some of the guys in 6 Feet Deep and even Clank. There's all these weird connections too. By the way, if you watch that Cornerstone video, Clank is playing with them in 95. And so that started as well. And you can access that music from their website. They have a ton of Left Out music on the Blamed's website as well, including their whole first album, Pride Kills, which I'm sure we're going to talk about on an upcoming episode.
I really like that album.
Yeah, I think we both do. So that, yeah, that's a lot of kind of the Blamed. And luckily, again, they're still kind of around today.
And by the way, The Church Is Hurting People is on Spotify.
Oh, okay, good. Yeah. Good.
All right, do you have an award?
You know, now having my discussion with you, I'm wondering if I want to change it, but I'm going to go with the one I had written down because it still works. This is the We're Right and You're Wrong Award.
Yes. They're, whatever the reason, they still got there.
Yeah.
Right? All right, Jay, what are we listening to on the next episode?
We are going to have a guest host, Derek, who is going to take us through Stave Saker's debut album, Friction.
All right. Jay and I, part of our goal is to have guests on that can take us outside of our comfort zones within the Christian music that we grew up listening to. And this isn't very far because it's still right in our wheelhouse of tooth and nail kind of stuff, but it is something that neither of us listen to.
Yeah, I'm not totally sure why. And again, same singer from this band was a drummer in that band. So lots right. of crossover even from this episode. So it should be fun. Thank you for joining us for another episode of Your Music Saved Us.
If you enjoyed your time with us, please leave us a review or share this episode. Visit our website, yourmusicsavedus.com, to find out all the ways to listen. We're on Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and Facebook. Join our Facebook group to keep up with us and interact with us. Send complaints and disagreements to yourmusicsavedus@gmail.com.
The music in this episode is the work of The Blamed and is used with apologies, not permission. And you can find The Blamed at theblamedband.com. Please check it out. You can also find a lot of their music on Spotify. Go listen to it. Go buy their albums. And yeah.
Wear a shirt.
Exactly. Actually, they did have some Frail shirts on the website for a while. So, and they have Represent. Some for 21. So there you go. If you like it, get a shirt.
All right. Thanks, guys.
We're out. Bye. I'm sorry. I was wondering if you could. Oh, well, I hope it's not too bad. Hopefully when I'm talking, you can't hear it. We'll see. I don't know.
We'll see. All right.
Not home or I tell her to shut the door up, but there we are.
I always forget who starts. I think I start. Nope, you start. Sorry, you start. And you want to know a weird confession?
Sure.
This, like, bass-heavy, lag of treble kind of guitar stuff makes me feel like I need to poop sometimes.
It's not been the effect on me, but interesting.
Yeah. I don't think that's the entire reason I don't like it, but it's probably not a small part of it. All right.